Hi all, welcome to Smart Leaders IAS. Today in this video, we will be briefly discussing about the form loan waivers. Before getting into a deep analysis of this topic, we will have a brief look into the importance of agriculture in economy of a country. Agriculture is normally termed as primary sector. Agriculture being the primary sector of industries in a country, they play a major role. Let's consider the case of India. More than 50% of the Indian population is employed in agriculture. But the share of agriculture in Indian GDP is only 17%. There is skewed distribution of manpower. And this skewed distribution has manifested in many problems for the agri community. One of those important problems is agri-indebtedness. This indebtedness can be formal or informal. The formal credit includes the loans taken from cooperative societies, banks, and other financial agencies. Whereas informal credit includes the loans taken from local moneylenders. And these loan waiver initiatives undertaken by the governments, they focus only on this agri-indebtedness. This indebtedness is, as we discussed earlier, this agri-indebtedness is only one of the problems that is plaguing the Indian agriculture system. There are many structural and functional reforms yet to be undertaken in the agri-economy of the country. This skewed focus on one particular issue, which is caused by skewed distribution of manpower. This skewed focus on agri-indebtedness caused by skewed focus on one particular factor of production has put up India's agriculture system in a strange scenario. Here we will see the problems associated with the loan waivers, and we will also discuss about the reforms should be undertaken in the process in order to increase the efficiency of the process. Before getting into that, we have to know the history of form loan waivers in India. In India, the first ever form loan waiver was done in the year 1990 under the Janata government. Later, the second instance was given in the year 2007 and UPA 1. These two initiatives were focused on the prevailing agri distress in India. And now the situations are different. The contribution of agriculture to Indian GDP were comparatively higher during the 1990 and 2007. Now the contribution of agriculture in GDP has fallen to 17%. Considering the lower contribution of agriculture to Indian economy, there has been questions raised by a few economists that whether spending on loan waiver would provide any tangible results, whether this agri loan waiver can be a sustainable and rational move. This question is being posed by various economists. There are various factors that is causing pain to the farmers in India, but this agri indebtedness is one of the direct point of pain. The governments in different states, they are trying to address this direct point of pain by providing loan waivers. As we discussed earlier, agriculture in India is facing various hurdles, and this indebtedness is one of these hurdles, and this indebtedness has been caused by various other factors. Rather than focusing on the disease, the states are now focusing on the symptom. Disease is agricultural distress, and the distress is caused by low MSP, high input cost, lack of value addition, cartelization in markets, vagaries of monsoon. All these causal factors lead to agri distress, and the agri distress is diagnosed indebtedness of farmers. Rather than focusing on these causing factors, the government is directly focusing on this agri indebtedness. The mounting debt burden of the farmers is pushing the farmers towards committing suicides. The National Sample Survey Organization study indicates that more than 52% of India's farming households are indebted as of now. And in few underdeveloped agri-dependent states, the rates are higher. More than 90% of the agri households are indebted. Even the recently released NABARD report on rural household also supports this claim. And the major problem is the credit balance is tilting towards the informal credit. Formal credit has very low prevalence in many rural parts of the country. This is another area of concern. As we discussed earlier, the systemic failures in the agricultural economy has pushed the farmers towards indebtedness. And this loan waiver is nothing but acknowledgement that the government has failed in providing structural and functional reforms in agricultural system of the country to move to push the farmers out of the indebtedness. Apart from the factors we discussed earlier, there are a few other factors. The first is lack of compensation during drought and disasters. Even the compensation offered by the central government or the state government in the recently cyclone hit delta part of Tamil Nadu was inadequate. The second factor is the failure of crop insurance scheme like Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. This insurance scheme has been made mandatory for the loany farmers, the farmers who has taken loan from formal institutions like banks. As we discussed earlier, most of the agri credit is from informal sources. So the farmers who has availed loans from banks, they enjoy the advantage of crop insurance, whereas the non-loany farmers, they won't enjoy the crop insurance facilities. So even this is one of the important failure of crop insurance scheme. Also, the delay in paying compensation, low rate of compensation offered by the insurance companies, they have also resulted in failure of these crop insurance schemes. And the third point is the deficit in prices. See, a farmer decides to grow a particular crop in that particular season based on the price of that particular food grain in the previous season. So due to various factors, the price fluctuates and the faltering minimum support price leads to price deficit. This pushes them into the trap of debt. The loan waivers, rather than being used as a tool to push the farmers out of their distress, it is being used as a political tool. The actions of the governments are taken considering their own political interests and not based on the interest of the farmer. Any problem warrants an immediate solution. Even this agri-indebtedness needs an immediate solution, a temporary solution. But this temporary solution should be backed by a long-term permanent systemic solution. Instead of focusing only on the symptoms, the government should focus on the causal factors. Economists and the experts have suggested few reforms have been recommended by the economists and experts for this portfolio of agri-credit. First reform is to introduce functional institutional credit system. Majority of Indian rural households are financially illiterate. There has been various initiatives taken by the government to provide financial literacy to the citizens of the country, but it has not yielded the required results. This lack of awareness and lack of knowledge about institutional credit reduce the chances of a rural farmer to avail credits from institutional bodies. So the first step towards providing institutionalized credit facilities to farmers, as a first step, we should ensure guaranteed access to institutional credit. The existing frameworks of credit system focusing only on landowners, the sharecroppers, tenants, and the vulnerable sections of the society like Adivasi and women farmers, animal rearers, they are not being provided with the institutional credit. But they also form an important part of rural agricultural households. So the government should undertake steps to provide the formal credit even to sharecroppers, tenant farmers, vulnerable marginal farmers and animal rearers. Recently, a study was undertaken by an NGO, Raitu Swaraja Vedika, and this study indicates that more than 75% of farmer suicide in the state of Telangana are from the tenant farmer community. Crop insurance scheme provided by the state governments are applicable only to the landowners. The sharecroppers or tenant croppers, they won't enjoy the security of insurance. So the distress faced by the tenant farmers is manifold comparing to the landowner. Even in the recently launched Raitu Bandhu scheme of Telangana, the focus is mainly on landowners. They are provided 8,000 per acre towards input cost of agriculture, whereas the tenant farmers are not being provided with any support. And this data indicates that tenant farmers need more support than the landowners. Structural changes by providing inclusive coverage even to the sharecroppers and the tenant farmers is needed. Reserve Bank of India in 2014, they provided loan swapping facilities for landless farmers, wherewith the informal credit taken by these landless farmers would be refinanced by the bank and it would be taken over as formal credit. But this has not been implemented in ground and it is still existing only in paper. Steps should be taken by the government in order to implement these guidelines. The first proposed reform is related with financial inclusion. The second proposed reform is related with providing compensation for disaster. The definition of disaster even covers drought. Drought is a meteorological phenomenon and it has got manifold impact on the functioning of agriculture in India. If you go back to the annals of modern Indian history, we tend to notice many famine commissions established, like the Strachey Commission and the Atchison Lee Commission. And the main role of these commissions were to interact with the farmers, interact with the rural people, and based on that, they decided, they finalized the compensation amount. And this was an inclusive approach. This approach was not followed in independent India until recently. A few years back, the government of Kerala, they initiated this colonial practice of creating commission, famine commission or debt relief commission. Falling in the line of famine commission, Government of Kerala had established this Kerala Farmers Debt Relief Commission. This debt relief commission works on various factors causing distress to the farmers, like natural disasters, pest attacks, input costs and other crucial factors are being analyzed, and after that the commission recommends the certain areas as distress affect in a particular year. This inclusive approach is based on various factors and this would provide a clear picture of a localized region. These kind of specific localized actions is required in all states. Based on this distress findings, they would recommend for loan rescheduling, interest waiver, one-time settlement, discharge of debt in installments, or even in extreme situation, they even recommend waiver of debt. The powers of this commission applies not only to the institutional loan, even non-institutional loans are also under the ambit of this commission. So, the inclusive nature of this debt relief commission has yielded successful results in the state of Kerala. Even other states should fall in line and introduce this mechanism to provide a functioning solution for the problem. These farm loan waivers are being used as a political tool to garner votes. With the already widening fiscal deficit of the country, providing doling out farm loan waivers would jeopardize the financial position of the country. But this farm loan waiver is not a wrong step forward. This is an incentive provided by the state to its citizen. Like other equality policies undertaken by the government, even this farm loan waiver does face some incentive problem. It results in declining of credit habit of the farmers. It makes farmers lazy. These are the criticisms plied upon the farm loan waiver. But the government should focus on the causal factors of agri-distress rather than focusing only on loan waivers. The government should focus on creating structural platforms for alleviating the other problems plaguing the Indian agricultural sector. Thank you.